Joining us is former AFL player Nathan Brown and former transgender rugby league football player Caroline Layt. Now, Nathan, I might start with you if that's okay. I want to know where you stand on this. Should transgender athletes be allowed to compete equally with women?
Yeah, as you said, it is a very complex situation at the moment and one that we haven't probably thought of in the last few years up until now, and probably this debate is going to go on for a long time. But I believe all athletes should be able to compete equally. I think everybody should be afforded the right to play. The grey area at the moment, and the one the AFL is going through, is in professional sport, I guess, in the AFLW, where there is prize money, where there is player payments, and where there might be what they think is an advantage of a male becoming a female in that competition due to strength. So it's a real grey area, and it's a hard one to tackle.
Yeah, I mean, and I think the AFL should be applauded here for taking on the conversation. Caroline, if I can go to you, I mean, you started as a male rugby league player before transitioning 20 years ago when you were 30. You then played in the women's league. What hurdles did you face?
Most of it was good, Alison. I had a really bad year in 2005 when I had previously played in 2004. When I hadn't disclosed, and I reaped a lot of rewards. But in 2005, I was outed, and then I was given, probably a pretty hard time that year. But after that, 2006 to 8, well, everything was just positive, you know, like my coaches and the manager for Sydney, they were just all fantastic. And the people that had been untoward to me, they were taken out of the equation. They lost their roles as Sydney coaches and things like that. And then I transferred to league and had a good career there too, representing New South Wales. And so most of it was positive. The players were good. And it was just probably one really bad year for me. So, yeah, so I can't really complain other than to say other than that one year. And look, there were sometimes snide remarks that I would hear back. But nothing was ever said untoward to my face. It was more like I'd hear things back behind, oh, Caroline's got an advantage, and that sort of thing. So, yeah.
Well, did you have a physical advantage over the other female players?
Well, that's the thing. I was tested because I have a sprinting background. So I came back as a masters athlete before I played football because I was in my mid-30s. And I had tests with had a max VO2 test, and my reading was 39.5 megalitres of oxygen, and that's well within the female range. Kathy Freeman was tested around similar time by those guys at Sydney University, and she was around about 49-50 megalitres of oxygen. So so oxygen with women is a lot less than what it is with men in the bloodstream, so the level. So I was well within the female range, so that was the marker back then. So I felt, and I was allowed to play, I was allowed to compete. So I had done the tests and passed them. So as far as I was concerned, with the hormones I'd been on, my body had feminised. I was 2.5 seconds slower. I went to Joey's. I ran 11.2. My best times were low 11s as a male athlete. And then when I came back competing as a mass athlete, I was running 13.5. So I lost 2.5 seconds in speed. So my body had feminised. So, yeah.
Nathan, can I ask you, what do you think of these tests the AFL is proposing for transgender athletes?
Yeah, look, they're pretty hard tests. So I don't understand a lot of the biology. I don't understand a lot of the testosterone requirements. I know you've got to have 5 mannanols of per litre, which is obviously, when you say that, a lot of people go, what is that? I don't understand. But I guess I'm not an expert in that. But what I do know is AFL football. And as a male athlete, do you have an advantage in AFL? I think you do. In terms of height and your power, and it is very much a height and power game. So players like Hannah Mouncey, and I think she's doing great things for the transgender community, but she does have an advantage in weight and power and strength when it comes to our game. If you're talking about gymnastics, bigger people don't do gymnastics just because physiologically they're not that good at it, because they need to be small. In AFL, you need to be bigger, you need to be stronger, and they probably do get an advantage from that.
Well, Hannah at 100 kilos was considered a physical threat to the other players. So do you think it was right that she was knocked back?
Well, we don't understand a lot about it. So the AFL knocked that back originally. The part I don't understand is she was allowed to play VFLW and not AFLW. So there's a little bit of a grey area on that occasion. But, I mean, we have guys in the AFL, Aaron Sandlands, who's 210 centimetres. We have Caleb Daniel, who's 160 centimetres. So there is a big range of people. I don't think the dangerous part is the physical part. I think it's the advantage. I think the worrying part is more the advantage that some players might get being bigger, being stronger, and I guess over history, that's why males and females don't compete against each other in the Olympics and I guess elite sports. It's a tough conversation to have, and we just obviously need to realise that we need to treat everybody case by case and with the respect they deserve.
So, Carolyn, do transgender athletes have an advantage?
I don't think so. Not after having undergone hormone therapy and treatment. I wouldn't say that someone should transition one day and then be competing the next. It's a time factor thing, and I agree with Nathan, it's a case-by-case basis because we all transition at different rates. And I think in talking about Hannah, it's been 3 years now, I think, I've been told, and the 5 nanomoles, it's just really, it's too low, like because there's health issues there, there's not enough testosterone in the body to keep playing. Just when you're exercising, you know, like for the body to recover. So 5 nanomoles is just too low, and that's been taken down from 10. There's no real scientific basis that they've based it on. So it needs to be addressed. And I think, well, when female athletes, they do a block of training, you know, they're up around about 14 nanomoles of testosterone. So it's and that's due to the training blocks they're on. And I've been told by some sports scientists that they don't get their period at that time because of the training they're doing and that, and there's more testosterone in the body because of the training they're doing.
Well, look, it's an incredibly important debate that we're having here. Nathan and Carolyn, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Okay.